NIT Trichy, over to you.
Sir, my doubt is in steam tables. Sir, in steam table, entropy is there. Entropy property is also there. You said that entropy, change in entropy only we can. Yeah, we can't find entropy at a point. And another doubt is internal energy also mentioned. What does it exactly? What is that internal energy? That quantity, 2500 or something, Hg or Ugr, Uf. What is that quantity indicates? Over to you.
Okay, the question is about the steam tables and what is tabulated in the steam tables. While it is true, and while not while, it is true that energy and entropy and all related functions like enthalpy, Gibbs function, Helmholtz function, they are all defined as differences. So when you look at your steam tables, you should be wondering how come a single value is written. For example, delta U. This is U2 minus U1. So we will need to specify two states and the table will become very complicated. So what we do is we write this, we define a reference state and U0 at that state. Consequently, what is tabulated, what this will be calculated as U2 minus U0 minus U1 minus U0. So it is this which is tabulated. This is a fixed state U0. So what is tabulated is U minus U0. And you notice on page 5 of your steam tables, first line in the in table 2, you will notice that the specific internal energy of saturated liquid at the triple point is defined at 0 and specific entropy at the saturated liquid state is also defined at 0. I am opening the steam tables, you will see it here, not table 1. First line in table 2. So this value, this is defined to be 0, that is saturated liquid at the triple point. Okay. So you can highlight this value which is defined to be 0, you can highlight this value, the specific entropy of saturated liquid at the triple point, it is defined to be 0. And the another value which is defined to be so in this table is the Celsius temperature at triple point, 0.01°C. Those are the three exact values in the steam table. Over to you.
Hello, sir. Sir, we have one more question. So this is regarding the efficiency of the Carnot cycle. So it speaks about the efficiency is 1 minus T2 by T1. So, but it says that there is it's not bothering about the working substance or a gas in it. But if you see in that other form, H1 minus H2, that this amount of heat absorbed and amount of heat delivered, that basically depends on the working substance. So in that way, one can tell that efficiency depends on the working substance. Is it correct, sir? Over to you.
The basic idea of the second law of thermodynamics says that efficiency of any reversible 2T heat engine is a function only of T at which heat is absorbed and T at which heat is rejected. Okay? And this is independent of working substance. Now, using this, we define thermodynamic temperature scale, and using that thermodynamic temperature scale, efficiency of a reversible 2T heat engine turns out to be 1 minus theta rejection divided by theta absorbed. This is on the thermodynamic temperature scale. Now, up to here no working substance come in. Then we said that use air or an ideal gas with constant Cp Cv in a reversible 2T heat engine. This is the Carnot cycle. Now, because we are using an ideal gas, the efficiency of this reversible heat engine will turn out to be in the parameters of ideal gas. It turns out to be, let us say, it will be function of the molecular weight of the ideal gas, CpCv of the ideal gas, and also the ideal gas temperature, because PV etc. is related to the T absorbed and T rejected on the ideal gas scale. When you do the analysis, we find that efficiency of a reversible 2T heat engine turns out to be 1 minus T rejected by T absorbed, where these are temperature on the ideal gas scale. And then we say, by Carnot theorem, the efficiency, whether calculated this way, whether calculated this way or whether calculated this way, this is not calculated, whether defined this way, should be the same. And that gives us the confidence to write that this expression must equal this expression. And from there we show that temperature on the ideal gas scale and the temperature on the thermodynamic temperature scale are the same. I think that should be understood. Over to you.
I have two Carnot engine, a reversible engine, which is functioning the temperature between T1 and T2, having the same work W. Now, is there any possibility of superposition of the work W plus W or like that? Is it possible? Over to you.
You have two Carnot engines. Carnot engines. That means two reversible 2T heat engines, same T1 and T2, and same W net. Now, what happens is, let me sketch. This is T0, this is T1, this is T2. Okay. And there is one engine, let me say E1, again reversible, so RE1, it produces a W. We have RE2, if that also produces W. Let me write this as W1 and W2. That means W1 is W2. Now, since they are reversible heat engines, same T1 and T2, that means by Carnot theorem corollary, you must have eta 1, eta 2 equal to eta 2. And since efficiency is the ratio of work done to heat absorbed, if this is Q1 and Q2, that also implies Q1 equal to Q2, and by energy balance or by first law, sorry, this is Q1 1 and Q1 of 2, and this is Q2 of 1 and this is Q2 of 2, and Q1 of 1 should be Q1 of 2 and Q2 of 1 should be equal to Q2 of 2. So, except for perhaps their internal working, externally where it comes to work interaction, efficiencies and heat interactions, the two machines have to be identical. But they may differ in their working internally. One may be based on air, another may be based on water vapor or some other material, it does not matter. Cummins Pune, over to you.
Good afternoon, sir. My question is related to SNTEL, in which a system is considered to be absorbing heat from condensing steam and rejecting heat to the atmosphere while undergoing expansion, and after applying the first law and second law, we could able to derive the given equation, but we could not understand what do you mean by show that any irreversibility in the process gives rise to a wastage of thermal energy of steam by an amount. So I want the interpretation of this statement, please.
Okay.
Which gives rise to a wastage of thermal energy of the steam. Over to you, sir.
If you look at this, is a non-cyclic process. A system undergoes a change in state represented by delta E, delta S and delta V. It is given to us that it absorbs heat from steam at TS. Either you can say TS is here, or this is better, right? This is TS, and you say this is Q, is the amount of heat absorbed from the TS. Then you have an interaction with the ambient, say at temperature T naught, and let us say that the heat absorbed from the ambient is Q naught. This Q naught is not mentioned here, but let us leave it as an algebraic thing. Then this delta V, let us say that delta V could be modeled as a cylinder piston stuff of the thing, and there is a P naught. All that it means, because it says here that the and work done in displacing the environment, that is the only work output. So that means there is a W which will be equal to P naught delta V. Now you should have applied first law to this. First law is Q equals delta E plus W, and Q is made up of two components, Q plus Q naught. Okay. This is delta E plus W, W is P naught delta V. This is first law. I think when you apply second law says that delta S is greater than or equal to integral dQ by T or summed over Q by T naught as appropriate. In this case, this gets replaced by delta S, and delta S should be greater than or equal to Q by TS plus Q naught by T naught. Okay. Now the question is, if you eliminate Q naught between the two, you will get an expression which says Q is greater than equal to something, some expression. Okay. And in that expression, if you put equal to that, you will get Q min, and Q minus Q min is the answer. Now the interpretation is, let me say this is equation 1, this is equation 2. Equation 2 can be converted to an equality. Equation 2 can be converted to using SP, entropy produced, which will always be greater than or equal to 0. Okay. So that way your second equation can be written down as SP plus Q naught by T naught plus Q by T s is delta S. Okay. And let me say this is 3. Now if you eliminate Q naught from 1 and 3, you will get an expression for Q equal to something and a term containing something into SP. Remember that SP is always greater than or equal to 0. So Q min will be the same right hand side of this with the condition SP equal to 0. So the minimum heat will be absorbed when you produce no entropy, and Q minus Q min is the wastage of thermal energy of steam. I suppose now you will be able to appreciate the wastage of thermal energy of steam. Over to you.
Thank you, sir. Over and out.
Amruta, Coimbatore, over to you.
Hello, sir. Good afternoon, sir. I am Ravindran from Amruta. I have a question regarding entropy. Can you hear, sir? We know very well entropy means change in entropy. The change in entropy means increasing of entropy there. But in a reverse process, that is decreasing entropy there. Is it possible, sir? Practically, is it possible for a reverse cycle? If it is possible, can you explain with the example, sir?
See, your question is, can entropy decrease? Remember, entropy is a function of state. So over a process, delta S equals S2 minus S1 can be positive, that means it can increase, can be 0, need not change, can be negative. There is nothing wrong about entropy for any process to be negative. For example, our basic entropy relation is delta S is greater than or equal to integral dQ by T. Or for a process element, dS is greater than or equal to dQ by T. All that is, it is greater than equal to that is needed. So it is possible that this is 4 units, this is 3 units. It is possible that this is 0 units, this is minus 2 units. It is also possible that this is minus 3 units and this is minus 4 units. nothing wrong in it. This is algebraically greater than or equal to. That's it. Okay. Now illustration. Take for example your let us take steam, and you have why steam? You just take let me go to the next page. You have a just a pail of hot water. Say it is at 1 bar and it is at 80 degrees C, and the ambient is at 30 degrees C. So you wait for some time, there is some amount of heat absorption, which is see heat absorption, that means heat absorbed is heat loss, so heat absorbed is less than 0. So this temperature may come down from 80 degrees to say 50 degrees C. So your state 1 is 1 bar 80 degrees C, state 2 is 1 bar 30 degrees C, and you will find that S2 is greater than S1. So many natural processes have S2 less than S1. Okay, so many natural processes have S2 less than S1. There is absolutely nothing special about this. Remember, we wrote delta S is greater than or equal to, or in the differential form we wrote d. I think I have it somewhere, but I do not have access to it just now. We wrote ds equals dq by t plus dsp, and this we change, say, is change in entropy. This can be positive, this can be 0, this can be negative. Then dq by t is related to heat flow. You absorbed heat, it will be positive. You do not have any heat transfer, adiabatic, it will be 0. You reject heat, this will be negative. So all three are possible here. Whereas here, this is so called entropy produced, and actually this is the defining equation for that. The second law says that ds has to be greater than or equal to t dq by t. That means this term can never be negative. So this can be positive, this can be 0, but this can never be negative. It can't be negative is dictated by second law. When it is 0, it is a reversible process, and when it is positive, it is an irreversible process. This is an impossible process, it just can't take place. These rows are not linked to each other, the just columns are important. I suppose now you should be able to understand. Over to you.
We have one more question, sir.
Sir, this is Krishnan from Amrita. My question is there any example for a quasi-static process, any practical example? Another thing, if so, can we consider the natural degradation of a dead body as quasi-static process, or the natural discharge from a battery as quasi-static? Over to you.
See, the quasi-static process That means each state in equilibrium. In actual practice, this means each state in almost equilibrium. That means very near equilibrium. How near equilibrium? It is for us to decide, and it will depend on what you want to do with it. Now, for example, just now I took an illustration of a pail of water reducing in temperature from 80 degree C to 50 degree C under 1 bar pressure. Now, this is a common enough thing. We have boiled water or we have heated it, water or milk. We can drink it only when it is near 40 or at most 45 degree C. So, we want to, before serving it to people, we wanted to bring it down to tea, milk, even warm water or something like that. We want to bring it down to somewhere near 50 or 45 degree C. We let it cool by rejecting heat to the ambient, and for rejecting it faster, maybe we stir it or do something. Now, suppose we stir it, you know, move it, then you will notice that as you stir it, there are pressure variations from one point to another point. Sometimes we dip it in another big vessel of water containing water at say 30 degree C. If you are in a hurry, you will put ice cubes in it. When that happens, temperature here will be slightly lower than the temperature here. And if you really take a, you know, microscopic measurement or very fine measurement, you will say that it is a non-quasi-static process. But once you are near 80, once you are near 50, you take it out, it is almost 50, and you can determine the amount of heat loss by just using your Cp delta T formula or whatever. So, for our practical purposes, it is quasi-static. So, whether to consider a process to be quasi-static or not is not told to us by thermodynamics, it is for us to decide. And as you said, many natural processes of decay, okay. At our scale, now human beings have a patience of typically a few minutes or at most a few hours. So, anything which seems to be slower than that for our purpose is really quasi-static. But something which you know, starts decaying pretty fast, goes bad in minutes, then naturally that will not be considered quasi-static by us human beings. So, it is a matter of degree and it is for us to decide. Generally, natural decay processes are can be modeled or can be considered quasi-static. But then other processes, for example, you have a hot plate and you spray fine drops of water in it. They immediately sputter into vapor and they flash into steam. That may not be quasi-static if you want to analyze it. It happens in fraction of a second. Over to you.
Kibiotic and isothermal at a time. So, is there any process so, and can we give the example of a thermo flask for that? Over to you.
Processes are defined by either interaction or the path they follow. For example, qualifications like isothermal, isobaric, constant volume, these are states, sets of states on the periphery of on the state space. Adiabatic is something which happens at the boundary. I will sketch a diagram and show it to you. see, you take a system containing a gas or a fluid. It has a pressure, it has a volume, it has a temperature. And let us say this is the PV diagram of that, and these are the isotherms. When I say that I have an isothermal process, that only means that if I start from here, I am staying along this isotherm during the process, either one way or the other. That is all it means. Similarly, an isobaric process means if I start at this pressure, I must remain at that pressure. And a constant volume process means if I start at this volume, I must remain in that volume. It does not say anything about how that process is executed, particularly what happens at the boundary. Okay. So, Q is an interaction, W expansion and W stirrer are also interactions. Now, if you say this interaction is 0, then it becomes adiabatic. That is it. Now, remember that constant volume, if V is maintained constant, that means because expansion requires a change in volume, this you are preventing. But you may still be allowing stirrer work. So, a constant volume does not automatically mean no work, it only means no expansion work. So, remember, you can have a process which is adiabatic as well as isothermal, you can have a process which is adiabatic as well as isobaric, you can have a process which is adiabatic and constant volume. And if you want an illustration, open your exercise sheet, F1.4, this is adiabatic plus isobaric. Okay, now F2.13, I will go to the next page, so that in fact this is an incomplete problem in the sense interactions are not possible, are not determinable. So, you take F2.13. Okay. You have 1 kg of saturated liquid water at 100 degrees C evaporates isothermally into dry saturated steam. So, let me draw it on say the TS diagram. This is initial state 1, this is final state 2. Process given, specified. Specified isothermal, but 2 phases together hence isobaric also. So, as it is, the process will have to be isothermal plus isobaric. Now, if you consider this to be a cylinder piston in which it is expanding, like this, we are maintaining temperature constant, but it turns out that the pressure also turns out to be constant. Okay. Now, the third thing. Naturally, I cannot have volume constant, the isobar goes like this, this is the pressure of that process, this is the temperature of that process, and it remains isothermal and isobaric because the process is from saturated liquid to dry saturated state. Now, how does this process come about? Remember that if you apply first law and assuming that it is stationary, that means no change in energy other than in delta U, So you will get delta U equals Q minus W. Delta U is fixed, initial state, final state, nothing changes. Now out of W, one component is also fixed, and that is P delta V. Plus, I may have a stirrer here, providing me W stirrer, apart from the possibility of any heat transfer. So P delta V plus W stirrer. So all that I get is delta U is fixed, P delta V is fixed. All that I have to do is match Q minus WST so that this equation is satisfied. I can have no WST, only Q, or some WST and some Q, in which case it will be a non-adiabatic process, but can be made adiabatic. In which case all that I have to do is say that Q will be 0, hence my delta U will be equal to minus P delta V minus W stirrer. So provide enough W stirrer so that this equation satisfied. In that case, I will have a process which is isothermal plus isobaric plus adiabatic. There is nothing special about this. Over to you.
Sir, regarding any practical example?
This is a practical example.
I asked you regarding the this thing, thermoflask. Can it be taken as an example or any other example in practical? Over.
See, a thermoflask is a perfectly insulated stuff. You don't expect any change of state there. All that I can say is, assuming the it is perfectly sealed, then I can say, and if you neglect the thermal expansion or contraction of that, then you can say that it is a very slow quasi-static process, slightly non-adiabatic, because there is a heat transfer, but it is a very slow heat transfer. That is about it. But that thermos flask is not a situation. I can say at most it is very good approximation of a constant volume process, if it is sealed properly, and if it is like a you know, something which is in which you put liquid nitrogen but keep the spout open, you can say that it is a constant pressure process. Apart from that, you cannot say much about a thermos flask. COE Pune, over to you.
My question is regarding the morning topic, that is property relation. Can you explain the property relation for Clausius-Clapeyron relation? So that is given in our even the syllabus also. I didn't get that.
Okay, page 19. The so-called Clausius-Clapeyron relation. There are many ways of deriving the Clausius-Clapeyron relation. I will derive it by one way, purely by remaining within the domain of property relations. In fact, we will use the Maxwell's relations for it. Okay. The other way of deriving it, I will tell you later and leave that to you as an exercise. The Clausius-Clapeyron relation starts off or tries to determine the slope of the any saturation line, either the liquid vapor or solid liquid or solid vapor. So the slope of this line will be dP by dT sat. Since we are moving around the saturation line, pressure is a direct function of temperature, so we get an ordinary derivative. Now we will rewrite this in terms of the temperature, say temperature volume diagram. This is the saturated liquid line F, this is the dry saturated vapor line G, and let us say we are at a point somewhere here. This is at that particular, if you are saying this is the P naught, T naught, this is our T naught, and of course the constant volume line, so constant pressure line P naught will go like this. Along this whole line the temperature is T naught, the pressure is P naught, and we are looking at a point in between. Now consider the variation of temperature. At a higher temperature you will have a higher pressure, at a lower temperature you will have a lower pressure. Now I want to know how does the temperature behave with pressure. So although I have dP by dT sat, I can write dP by dT sat but in the two phase zone I can decide to go along a constant volume line, or I can go along say a constant entropy line, does not matter whichever way. So I can take this as partial of P, partial with respect to T along the V in the two phase zone, say liquid vapor, or I can say that this must also equal partial of P with respect to T along a constant entropy line in the two phase zone. Okay. Let us look at this. This choice also is possible, and I leave it to you to show that whether you take this or this, the final result is the same. Now notice partial of P with respect to T at constant V. Does it have a candidate in the Maxwell's relation? Yes, it has, because if I write this is PV TV, and I can replace PV by TS, so I get TS TV. Since T is the common factor here, I can write this as partial of S with respect to V at constant T. Okay. So my, again I am writing down this equation of the previous page, dP by dT dP by dT sat, which we took as dP by dT at constant volume but in the two phase zone, now turns out to be partial of S with respect to V at constant temperature in the two phase zone. Now in the two phase zone, how does S vary with T? How does S vary with, sorry, the entropy vary with volume? Remember, we are now looking at variation of entropy, this with volume. And how does it vary? Remember that we are looking at a constant temperature, and constant temperature line in the two phase zone is this line from point F to point G. And the variation of F is linear with x, variation of V is also linear with x, So this becomes SG. Sorry. So this can now be written down as SG minus SF divided by VG minus VF. And this gives us the first and the last, give us the Clausius-Clapeyron relation. dP by dT sat equals, this is written as SFG divided by VFG. And you can also show that SFG is T, sorry, is HFG divided by T. So this can also be written down as HFG divided by T into VFG. Now on the previous page, we had selected the first option, dT by dP at constant V, and not the second option, dP by dT at constant S. If you were to select the second option, all that would happen is, instead of this dS by dV at constant T, you will end up with dS by dV at constant P. But in the two-phase zone, dS by dV at constant T or dS by dV at constant P mean the same thing, because the isotherm is also the isobar in the two-phase zone. So you end up at precisely the same result. This result is the Clausius-Clapeyron relationship. Here we have derived it using the property relation. The other way of deriving it, I will only hint at it and leave it to you to complete the derivation. You do the following. You take, say, let us say you can sketch this on a PV diagram. Let us say this is the liquid dome. And let us say that these are two constant pressure lines, and hence within the two-phase zone from F point to G point, these are also two isotherms. Although the constant pressure lines will be horizontal, the isotherms will go like this. Okay, does not matter. This is the F part, this is the G part. Now let this be differing by a small pressure difference delta P, and hence a small temperature difference delta T. Okay. Now consider two isentropics within this, two distinct isentropics. Now remember that this looks like a Carnot cycle. It works between temperature T and temperature, say, T plus dT, and some, you say, some S1 and some S2. How much is the work done? Work done will be the area of this curve. How much is the heat transferred? Because it is an isothermal process, the heat transfer will be the temperature at which heat is absorbed multiplied by the entropy difference. Remember, dQ is TdS for a reversible process, and all the processes in a Carnot cycle are expected to be reversible processes. Okay. So calculate the area of this as integral dP dV. That is the work done. Calculate the area under this curve. It is simply the higher temperature T plus dT divided by whatever is the entropy difference that you have assumed, that is the heat transfer. Divide work done by heat transfer, and that will give you one expression for efficiency. But we know that a Carnot cycle is a reversible 2T heat engine cycle. So the efficiency would be 1 minus heat rejection temperature divided by heat absorption temperature. Okay. Equate the two and simplify, and you will get the Clausius-Clapeyron relationship. Although I wrote it as T and T plus dT, your algebra will be simpler if you write it as working between T the upper end and T minus dT the lower end. The algebra will be that much simpler, otherwise it is essentially the same derivation. Kukas, Jaipur, over to you.
Sir, good afternoon. My question is, what is the can you once again explain the procedure for getting the properties of subcooled liquid? Over to you.
Well, the question is properties for subcooled liquid. Okay. So, a system containing a subcooled liquid, one you should remember is a simple compressible system. Hence, specific volume, internal energy, entropy must be a function of temperature and pressure. But we notice that the subcooled liquid is almost incompressible. And the tabulation is too crude. Hence, for low P, say up to 50 bar, maybe up to 100 bar. Approximate computation of properties of subcooled liquid. Assume subcooled liquid to be incompressible. That means I will sketch the PT diagram and I will say this is the triple point and this goes towards the critical point. Okay. And we are somewhere in this zone. Say this is P naught, T naught. But we are saying the liquid here is incompressible, so there is no effect of pressure on the properties. No effect of P on properties. Which are properties? The basic properties. V, U and S. Of course, we have said incompressible, so obviously there is no effect of V, but incompressible means no two-way work mode. You can't compress it, you can't expand it. So properties must be functions of one variable, temperature. That means V must be a function of temperature only, U must be a function of temperature only, S must be a function of temperature only. Now consider this point, and along the same temperature, this is T naught, go along this line till you come to saturated liquid at T naught, and we say from here to here in this zone, same V U S. Why? Because same T, and hence I will go to the next page now, and hence we say V at T naught P naught will be V F at T naught U at T naught P naught will be U F at T naught and S at T naught P naught is H F at, sorry, S F at T naught. Okay. Provided T naught P naught in the subcooled liquid. The exception for this is H, because H at T naught P naught by definition is U at T naught P naught plus the pressure P naught multiplied by V naught, which is a function of P naught T naught. So if you substitute this, this becomes U F at T naught plus P naught into V F at T naught. Okay. So H depends on P, because P naught is physically present here. I think that should make the idea of our incompressible liquid scheme or model for estimating properties in the subcooled liquid zone very clear. Over to you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Over and all.
Pillai Panvel, over to you.
Sir, there are two questions. First one, can you explain internally reversible and externally reversible process with examples? And the second question is that LPG cylinder, what type of system it will be? Simple, complex or rudimentary?
So the first question is, what is internally reversible process and externally reversible process? We don't make any such classification. Our definition of the reversible process is very clear. Two systems which are interacting with each other and execute a process which takes A from A1 to A2 and B from B1 to B2 is reversible if the whole process can be reversed. That means B can be brought from B2 to B1, A can be brought by A2 to A1 using the same forward path which they traversed, and by reversing all the interactions in all details that they had with each other. So it is exactly like a movie in all its detail being able to be played back and still be true and consistent. That means the requirement is that if a reversible process is executed from A1 to A2, and because it is reversible, it is reversed back and systems come back to A1 and B1, then no trace of that process having been executed is ever maintained. You can't even make out whether that process had taken place or not. It's a very, very strict requirement, and such a process we can only think about and not even think of being able to execute. There is no need at all for us to define internal and external reversibility. There are some books which define it as internally reversible and externally reversible and so on, but I don't want to get into it. The second question was about the LPG cylinder, the cooking gas cylinder. The question is whether it's a simple system or a complex system. Okay. By cooking gas cylinder, I think what you mean is the gas inside the cylinder. And let us assume that the cylinder has a connection and the process is the pressure outside is low, the pressure inside is high, and it is liquefied petroleum gas. So you have some liquid and some vapor, and since it is liquid vapor in equilibrium and if the cylinder is not insulated, the pressure inside the cylinder will depend on its temperature, which will depend on what is the temperature in the ambient. Okay. Now, since we do not have a stirrer and we do not have any other type of work mode, I think it remains a simple system. There is no need to consider it as a complex system. It is an open system. If it remains closed, then there is nothing happening to it except pressure changing because of change in temperature, because of change in temperature of the environment. The moment it is an open system and something flows out, flowing out requires some work to be done, which is an expansion type of work, as we will see tomorrow when we consider open systems. So, and expansion type of work can be done only by a simple compressible fluid, or at least by a compressible fluid, simple or otherwise. So, in this particular case, I think the gas in the LPG cylinder or the fluid in the LPG cylinder can be very well modeled as a simple compressible system. But in a way you are right, if this cylinder is closed, then it is some sort of a restricted system, which is a rudimentary system, because in that case we do not have a pressure gauge, but if you have a pressure gauge on it, then that pressure will indicate the temperature of this, and that temperature will depend on the ambient temperature. So you will have a very crude thermometer, a vapor spring thermometer, as they say, that is available to you. Over to you.
Thank you, sir. Over and out.
Dhruba, Indore, over to you.
So my question is that, is it mandatory that isentropic process should be reversible adiabatic process? Over to you.
The question is it mandatory for an isentropic process to be a reversible adiabatic process? No. If you look up our yesterday's scheme of things, we looked at the thing first, the adjectives which we came across is adiabatic. Adiabatic means dQ is 0. then we came across an adjective which was reversible. Reversible, just I explained in the previous discussion what reversible meant, but if we define the entropy production, then reversible process is DSP is 0. And the third one was isentropic. The isentropic process was defined as one in which the change of entropy is 0. So, these three are three distinct adjectives, but they are not all that distinct, because DS, DQ and DSP are all related by this relation, the entropy relation and the second law in terms of entropy production. I will cross this, indicating this represents change of state, whereas these two represent interactions. And because of this is something like A equals B plus C, any one of them can be 0, the other two can have any appropriate value to satisfy this equation. But if two of them are 0, the third one has to be 0. That means of these three, adiabatic, reversible and isentropic, you take any one, that is okay. Other two need not be applicable. Because if DS is 0, the restriction here is only that DSP be greater than or equal to 0. Since DSP cannot be negative, if DS is 0, you could have this positive, this negative, and you will still have this 0. If DQ is 0, that means adiabatic, you can still have this positive, so the other two need not be satisfied. If you have DSP equals 0, that only means DS is DQ by T, either of them can be positive or negative. So any one does not imply any other two. So the answer to your first question is, an adiabatic process or an adiabatic process, should it be reversible isentropic? The answer is no. Or is an isentropic process, does it have to be reversible adiabatic? The answer is no. Similarly, a reversible process, does it have to be adiabatic isentropic? The answer is no. But you take any two of these three, you make 0 in this equation, the third has to be 0. So you take any two, this automatically implies the third. So if you make a process adiabatic and reversible, it should automatically be, or it will automatically be isentropic. You make a process isentropic and reversible, it will automatically be adiabatic. And if you make a process adiabatic and isentropic, it should automatically be reversible. Okay. So that is the question. And at this stage, I am saying over and out, because I am going for a cup of tea.